Now, some of you may have noticed that all is not harmony in these Isles of ours. In the far Celtic regions, the natives are becoming restless. In Who's Who, one famous Scottish poet lists his recreation as Anglophobia. It is a prejudice shared by my next guest, Scots author Gordon Williams, guests, I meant to say, and Valerie Wynne-Williams, all the way from English-dominated Welsh Wales. Taking all this on his chin, keeping a stiff upper lip, disdainfully raising an eyebrow, is Ted Moult, as English as raspberry jam. Sandra will talk to him later, but first let me deal with the Celtic fringe. Gordon, what have you got against the English?
I think there's far too many of them. And they live far too near Scotland. And they don't seem to really care very much about other people's worries and problems. They just say, oh, really, old boy. And I was brought up in the street where if you wore your dentures in midweek, that was the classification for middle class. And poverty was, or is still in Scotland, of a horrific nature compared to England in general. It's only a couple of years ago that they found in a Glasgow tenement there was no indoor sanitation, no hot water, anything like that, and the people were actually walking quarter mile to public convenience, which was a bit inconvenient in the middle of the night in a rainstorm, as you can imagine. Now, these kind of conditions are so horrific, bare feet and children, the squalor of Scotland. Now, what you'll find is this, that you come down to England. I remember going to a Scottish nationalist thing years ago when they were a party of cranks with kilts, vegetarians, nobody took them seriously. But they had one speaker and he said to us all at the monument to Sir William Wallace, the great patriot who was beheaded and quartered and his head taken around London as a sort of tourist thing. He said, the Englishman has all the qualities of a poker without its occasional warmth. And that, I'm afraid, is the picture that one has of the English. I was kissing my three English children goodnight as I was leaving to come to this thing. Don't watch this program because I'm actually going to say I hate you. But it's not actually the Englishman that one meets, the Ted Moult. I think of this bowler-hatted chap who's been making the money over the centuries, ever since the Scottish drunks were bribed into taking the union in Parliament.
Okay, well, let's hear what Valerie, what do you hate about the English or dislike about the English?
Well, let's establish it first of all. I don't hate the English. Some of my best friends are English, and like Violet Elizabeth, I don't hate them. But what I do hate, and that is the English bureaucratic state, and that is something different. Because to me, a state should be something that works for a nation and not a nation which is subjugated to the state. And this is what we have in Wales. We have a state of affairs where we as a nation are being destroyed by the state. And that is something they are trying to make me a second-class citizen in my own country. Not that they're succeeding for a moment.
What? Can I ask you, Valerie, when you discovered, because, I mean, you must have been brought up in school with the same queen, with the same national anthem, with the same selection of heroes, presuming the books came down from the Ministry of Education in London. When did you discover that you were, in fact, different?
Well, my Welsh history book, in fact, said that in 1282, the history of Wales finished, which gives you a context of what we had to put up with. Now, when did I become aware of being Welsh? I think it started about the age of 9. I can remember having a history lesson and the schoolmaster saying to me, Valerie, stand up. I stood up. And then he turned to the rest of the class and he said, now, here is a typical Iberian. The little dark people.
Sounds like a breed of sheepdog.
No, the little dark people who were living on this island 1,000 years before the Romans came. And that is the seed, I think, that first was set there, and I knew I was different.
What's your idea of the typical Englishman? Your image?
I think perhaps one does think of him as being rather a Colonel Blimp. But it isn't that. I think that what I do object in Englishmen is perhaps their arrogance towards us in Wales. The fact, more than anything, that they don't really sympathise the fact that we, as a nation, what makes us different is mostly the fact, the language. And that is the key. I mean, when, as a nation, you've got something very precious that you must transfer, your whole civilization, to the next generation. And the key to that in Wales is the language.
Isn't this something odd, and perhaps Gordon, but both of you, I mean, it seems to one in London that the whole of Scottish nationalism, the whole of Welsh nationalism is contained in the crowd at Hampden Park or the crowd at Cardiff Arms Park. Isn't that, if nationalism is only that, isn't that a failure of a nation, Gordon?
Yeah, but it's a failure of a nation because the nation has been destroyed. And for years, that going to Hampden Park with a half bottle of whiskey and singing, if you hate Alf Ramsey, clap your hands, clap your hands. Or whatever the England manager was, I hate the bloody lot of them, really. That was the only time you actually were a nation. There was 143. You never heard the Englishmen speaking at all. I mean, they kept very quiet. And that was your only chance. And you see that the thing has come now that I think education, and people can see that other countries are getting things through various forms of action. It's been Labour Party policy to have a government for Scotland since the days of Keir Hardie. And they have never once talked about it until the Scottish Nationalist Party once. I'm not actually in agreement with the National Party, but it just is indicative. I saw a programme the other night and two English MPs go up to Scotland. And they were amazed. They said, my dear chap, he said, I had no idea. They have their own radio programmes, you know. And I thought, he was an MP for Lancashire.
You live here, Gordon, don't you? Aren't you in fact biting the hand that feeds you?
Yeah, but the hand that feeds me is the one that destroyed the chance that ever I had of staying at home in that wonderful paradise north of Gretna Green. Were dragged away. Millions, there's a million in London.
You owe England and the English nothing?
Well, I think we owe them quite a lot for defending us from the Germans during the war, but then I think it was mainly the frontline regiments were all Scottish. At least that's what my mother told us. They put the Scots up there, and the English were all biting the mess
as
officers.
Think, you were telling me earlier about Bobby Moore. Why do you think they, and what you were saying to Bobby Moore and how he didn't understand why 140,000 stood up and said, if you hate Alf Ramsey, clap your hands. Why do you think the English don't have the same passion about it as you have?
Well, I mean, England's a huge country. And Scotland's only 5 million. It's like asking an American, why isn't he worried about the Red Indian? I mean, it's only like, we're like the Negroes in the Deep South, the Scottish and the Irish, I would suggest. We're second-class citizens. You've got to work twice as hard if you come to London. You have to come to London. There's nothing much up in Scotland except the rain and pubs and alcoholism, and that's about it. Right.
But surely the English are now starting to get head up about it with this question of devolution. Let's face it. I mean, now they're really getting... They're thinking that we in Wales and the Scottish people are going to get something that they're going to miss out on. And for the first time, you're having English nationalism coming into it.
Okay, let's hear from an English nationalist. Sandra.
Thanks, Llew. Well, Ted Moult, there's far too many of you. You're arrogant, you don't care about others, you're like a poker without warmth. Plead the case for the Englishman.
Well, of course there are too many of us because we've been diluted by Welsh and Scots. All the good ones have come here. You only got the dross left for a start. And, well, you know, I mean, okay, I can appreciate when you're in a majority, it's easy to become complacent. Security is what you have. And I can appreciate that it's necessary to the desires and anguish of the minority. And I appreciate the Welsh language. But why aren't we discussing it in Gaelic or Welsh? The reason is because the tribes can't understand each other for a start.
And I wouldn't understand a word you said.
I don't think the English wish to be defensive because they make. I mean, all right.
Is it because you're not passionate enough that you don't wish to be defensive? I mean, they've just talked about you as being unpassionate. That's not the right word. Impassionate.
Yes.
Not passionate.
Not passionate is what I'm
looking for. Passionate for what? You see, Gordon talks about the situation in the Gorbals. Well, I've been to the Gorbals, but what they don't realise, they want more this, more housing, more social services. That can only be acquired if they give less of something else. Now, what are they going to give up?
More decision-making is what we really want.
Oh, well, you can decide. I mean, any place, look. If you're a dry area or a wet area, I mean, you've got that prerogative for a start. I'll allow this, you see, Sandra. You can't ignore the Welsh. I've been to Smithfield all week, and there's no doubt Scotland, with less arable land than Yorkshire, they're doing the damnedest, aren't they, on nothing, have managed to get the champion and the reserve champion, Aberdeen Angus, cross Charolais, which is at least French. Then there's the Welsh pig breed. Which is absolutely full of Swedish land race, you see, and they'll deny it.
The thing will be eaten by Englishmen, that's the terrible thing. The first prize, the one with the red on it, will be eaten by Englishmen.
But why?
Oh, the Englishmen. Yeah, well, I mean, if you've got to demolish the capitalist system, we'll have another programme. That's,
do you think you're being arrogant, Ted?
Well, yes. Is it, my point is this. I love the. I mean, Scots and Welsh. And the Celtic fringe are very amusing people. They live on the fringe, the peripheral of the Great Britain. I always go to my holidays in Merry Isles. I've learned one or two Welsh words, like buwch, which is cat. Is that right? Is that
Thank
right?
you.
Thank you. I accept that. And Scotland, fantastic place. But consider what England have given them. And incidentally, William Wallace was killed in Smithfield, and I'm not defending Edward I. Terrible, William Wallace. But then...
You did give us a lovely thing, in fact. You gave us a beautiful castle in Carnarvonshire, which the English built, and it was English money that we built it. But the joke is on you, because we now go in for half price, and the English have to pay the full price to go and see their own castle.
Well, look back. Who are the worst swine in Wales and Scotland? I'll tell you, themselves. Who dismantled the clan system? Well, after the 45 Jacobite Rebellion, it was the clans who exported their labour to Canada because they wanted to get more money out of sheep runs. They abolished the Croft system. Who are the worst offenders? Who are the Merthyr Tydfil and the Welsh coal miners? They're their own Rachmanites, you see. So it's really, I know the Welsh feel strongly about the injustices during the Depression, but this wasn't common to Wales. It happened, you could also argue the case for Durham, Langston, many
other
places.
You got quislings in all countries that the Germans took over, didn't you? There's always eager cooperators who'll take advantage and jump in, and our landowners are treacherous swines. They learnt from the English their masters very quickly. The Duke of Argyll won the race to get to London to get his title.
Correct.
But the thing is, now that the people want a little bit of saying their own things, if we are so fringe and lunatic and needing all this subsidies from England, why is it such a reluctance to actually let us go?
No, if I were Prime Minister, I would have a referendum. I would rebuild Hadrian Wall with Irish Labour right up there, and I would put the facts clearly as far as humanly possible.
Why is it then that the English government at the moment is only willing to give Wales an assembly which has as much power as the local Women's Institute?
Because if they lose the Welsh MPs, they're a perpetual Conservative majority. You know that, without me telling you.
Gordon, do you ever feel you're being patronised?
Yeah, extremely patronised. Now, I write novels for a living, and some of them are quite good and some of them are pretty
rubbish. I'll buy one.
But...
just one.
But I just speak the way I did when I left Paisley, the street where the dentures are not worn in midweek, and I just speak the normal way. I had quite a good what would be called a grammar school education. When I went in the Air Force, and I went to a potential officer material camp on the purely statistic, you know, school certificate, I passed. But as soon as the guy heard me, he said, well, don't you bother filling in the forms.
No,
I said, why is that? He said, well, officers are required to speak properly.
But you've been an officer in a Scottish regiment?
No, an officer in a Scottish regiment, they speak as laddie does.
In Scotland, all the Coonty types speak English.
Exactly, yes.
And I'll tell you something else. It's a question of definition. Now, all this oil rubbish, not oil rubbish, it's very important. Who's got the most oil? Shetland. And who does Shetland belong to? Norway. You know, the king sits in Dunfermline Toon drinking the blue red wine. It was a dowry with Margaret. I don't believe in the balkanization of the United Kingdom, because I think that's... And once you let Scotland go, you'll have Northumbria, Cornwall...
Yeah. Well,
and what the hell? Who gave rugby to the Welsh?
The
William Webb Ellis. And they said, he picked the ball up and he said to the master, Dr. Arnold at rugby, what will I do with it now? And that's why it's such a funny shape. How can they express themselves more than Murrayfield?
You can't be an internationalist unless you are proud of a nation, unless you belong to a nation. I mean, it is rubbish. It's contrary in terms to call yourself an internationalist and not respect a nation for what it stands for.
You've got to do that.
We want to become a part of the United Nations, and we want a voice in the European community, our own voice, because we think we in Wales have got terrific problems, like Gordon said, in Scotland. And to do anything about this, we really must have our own power. And it's a saying in Wales, a sneeze in London and it's pneumonia in Wales.
Last 10 seconds.
Well, I'm an internationalist, but I think all these things could be taken care of without the dismantling of the United Kingdom at the moment.
If you were in their position, would you hate them?
No, I don't hate anybody. No.
All right.
King sits in Dunfermline too. And there, having done our best to spill the milk of human kindness, we leave you.